Welcome to the third episode of Clubs and Spades, brought to you by the Calcutta Heritage Collective. The Calcutta Heritage Collective is a voluntary initiative formed by a group of passionate Calcuttans from varied walks of life, with the sole purpose of preserving and showcasing the rich cultural and architectural heritage of our city, and more so its built heritage. The objective is to create awareness and inculcate a sense of pride in Kolkata's built heritage. This is done through events such as walks, tours, interactive and educational sessions, quiz for the younger children, among many other things. In these series of talks, titled Clubs and Spades, we endeavor to highlight the rich and fascinating history and culture of the clubs of Calcutta, which have always been such an essential part of the city's social fabric. Today, we will showcase the historic and premier Royal Calcutta Golf Club, a club which needs no introduction and is affectionately known by its tag Royal or simply RCGC. Founded in 1829, Royal is the oldest golf club outside the British Isles. The golfing heritage and history of Royal makes this a truly hallowed place for the game of golf. Sometime, you know, while researching this, we were able to get a clip of the RCGC, which was shot in the 1960s. And it shows the unhurried and delightful atmosphere of the club, far from the din of the city. Let's have a look.
Four. Straight down the middle. It went straight down the middle. Then it started to hook just a wee bit. And that's when my caddy lost sight of it. That little white pellet has never been found to this day. But it went straight down the middle, like they say. Whack down the fairway. It went smack down the fairway. Then it started to slice just a smidge off line. It headed for two, but it bounced off nine. My caddy says, long as you're still in the state, you're okay. Yes, it went straight down the middle, quite a way.
So that was just a little clip which we found, you know, while researching on RCGC. The focus these days when it comes to golf is generally on the professionals, and that it is a game for the elite. And the pots of money which is available to them at tournaments all across the world. But history has a great affinity for amateur golf. For it all began with playing for fun and passion. Money followed much later. And in that sense, the Royal has been the nursery for Indian golf. The club produced quite a few India's best golfers, Arjuna Awardees and winner of gold medals in the 1982 Asian Games. It has also produced a number of champions from different walks of life, like Jamshed Ali and Firoz Ali. The most famous of these is SSP Chaurasia, the son of a greenkeeper at the Royal, who has won the Indian Open on two occasions and multiple events on the European tour. Apart from golf, the club offers many facilities such as tennis, swimming, billiards, and a gym, and also hosts a number of social events, which are quite a highlight in the city's calendar. It is also unique that as being a club to have a second home within the city, the Maidan Pavilion. We have with us two eminent speakers to take us on this journey to learn more about the RCGC. Mr. Ashok Malik and Dr. Satbinder Singh. Welcome, gentlemen. Dr. Singh, can I please ask you to unmute yourself? Mr. Ashok Malik is a renowned golfing personality and Arjuna Awardee, a five-time winner of the All India, a six-times winner of the All India Seniors, and he's also the first amateur or professional to win a national event outside the subcontinent, the 1977 Singapore Amateur Championship. He has also won about 150 events at the RCGC, including the Eastern India Amateur 14 times and the Club Championship 23 times. Golf actually comes naturally to Mr. Malik, as he's also the son of Mr. I.S. Malik, who himself was a golfing legend. He is currently based out of Delhi. Hello, sir.
Hi.
Dr. Satbinder Singh is a keen golfer, having served on the club committee in various positions for several years. He is an alumnus of UC Berkeley and has completed his doctorate in engineering from University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign, USA. Dr. Singh was also a council member of the Indian Golf Union and has also been the chairman of the National Golf Academy of India. Hello, sir.
Hi, Gaurav.
So, starting with you, Mr. Malik, can you tell us about how actually RCGC came into being, starting from its earliest days?
Yeah, thank you, Gaurav. The RCGC, as you mentioned, is the oldest golf club outside Britain and perhaps the second oldest outside Scotland, with the Royal Blackheath in England being slightly older. It was established in March 1829 as the Calcutta Golf Club with Lord Ramsay as the captain and had a nine-hole course in Dum Dum. Proof of the year of inauguration was the existence of a large number of brass buttons which bore the Scotch Thistle Golf Arms and the motto Far and Sure. On the grant of the Royal Charter, the crown was added on to the crest of the club. And this is a picture of the crest as it exists today. A picture of the course at Dum Dum in 1892 is shown over here. It may be of interest to note that in the year 1895-96, the annual subscription was rupees 30, and a picture of a receipt with a one-anna stamp is shown here.
That's amazing. Actually, in today's time, it just seems incredible. So when did the Calcutta Golf Club become Royal Calcutta Golf Club?
From the minutes of a meeting held in November 1912, we have learned that the grant of the Royal Charter was conveyed to the club by the Chief Secretary of the Government of Bengal, that His Imperial Majesty the King Emperor had been graciously pleased to grant the title of Royal to the Calcutta Golf Club in commemoration of Their Majesty's visit to Calcutta in the early part of that year. An indication of the high esteem in which the club was held was the fact that even before the Royal Charter, the Viceroy and Governor General of India, His Excellency the Earl of Minto, was a patron of the club of the years 1908 to 1910. Successive viceroys and after independence, the presidents of the country have also consented to be patrons. Additional patrons have been the governors of Bengal and now West Bengal. The Dum Dum course closed down in the year 1897. However, in addition to the nine-hole course at Dum Dum, the club had two nine-hole courses on the Maidan. There are no details available to show when these actually opened for play, but it was on record that sometime after the club started in 1829, these two courses came into existence, and one of these extended up to the area where the Victoria Memorial now stands. One may have been closed or modified when the Victoria Memorial came up, and the remaining course closed in 1939.
Wow, that's truly fascinating, sir. So in those days when golf was being played, did they have a clubhouse or what were the arrangements for the members?
In the early years, there was no clubhouse as such, and premises in Dum Dum were rented or a tent pitched on the Maidan for use of members. In 1884, permission was obtained from the authorities to put up a pavilion on the Maidan and a budget of 6,000 rupees was sanctioned. The Maidan Pavilion of the club was opened in January 1985 and was built entirely of teak wood by Messrs. Byrne and Company. This is a picture of the Maidan Pavilion, which still exists. The Maidan facility also provided for bowls. Here's the additional building that came up sometime in the last 25 years or so. The Maidan facility also provided for bowls, which continues till today, and originally also provided tennis courts, which no longer exist. Apart from the bowling members who use the green regularly, the Maidan Pavilion is very popular with almost all other members, as it is conveniently located close to the Dalhousie Square office area. Members often meet here to discuss business or have a drink before heading home.
So, sir, when did the move to Tollygunj actually really happen?
Well, after the closure of the Dum Dum location, the committee were on the lookout for a new site, and a search in the Tollygunj area commenced as early as 1903. Several sites, including an area west of the Tollygunj Club, were looked at before the present location, which consisted mainly of paddy fields, was finalized. Progress in land acquisition was slow, and in 1907, when only a part of the land was in the possession of the club, the committee decided to start work on the course. Debentures had to be issued to raise funds, and the annual sub went up from rupees 30 to rupees 60, and the entrance fee from rupees 70 to 75. These figures look absolutely insignificant today, but must have caused quite a great deal of debate at that time.
I'm sure.
On Sunday, the 20th November 1910, a nine-hole course was opened. Unfortunately, no map of this layout is available. Finally, the 18-hole course was opened for play on Sunday, the 22nd of December 1912, with a formal opening on the 11th of February the next year, 1913. Some early pictures of the construction of the course are available, and these are shown here. At the bottom of the last of these pictures are the two designers of the course, J.A. Tassey on the left, a member of the committee from 1908 to 1913, and J.A. Anderson, the honorary secretary. Work on the clubhouse started in 1913, and the first stage was completed in 1914. It was later extended in 1929. The building was designed by a Mr. McNichol, a member of the club who worked for McIntosh Byrne, the foremost architects in Calcutta at that time. We have a picture with us showing the clubhouse and the Shamiana. This was taken around 1950 and shows only one Shamiana which existed at that time. The second or mixed Shamiana came in later. Apart from the other view that you saw, we have an aerial view of the clubhouse, and in the lawn in front is a sundial which has the date 1828 inscribed on it. Since it is close to the year when the club started, a member bought it while on leave in the UK and presented it to the club in the year 1916. It still stands where it was installed in that year.
This is amazing. Yes, sir.
Go ahead.
So we understand that, the membership swelling immediately as the club had opened. So a second course was opened. Can you tell us more about this?
Yeah, that is correct. Soon after the course at Tollygunj was opened, membership swelled, and the committee decided to keep buying more land to open a second 18. By the end of 1923, 11 holes of the new course were open for play, and by August 1924, this had increased to 14 holes. The full 18 was completed in 1925. Both courses were busy till the 1960s. The two courses were officially called the old and the new course, following the example of the two courses at the home of golf, the Royal and Ancient Golf Club of St. Andrews. If any member made the mistake of referring to them as the A and B course, they were in danger of losing their membership. As I mentioned, both courses were full over the weekends until 1966, when following the big devaluation of the rupee, many expatriates left the country. play further came down appreciably during the difficult period from 1967 to 72. And in the last couple of these years, there were a lot of clashes around the perimeter of our course and quite often on the club property itself. It was not uncommon to find bodies on our course, and it was therefore reluctantly decided in 1972 to close the new course and sell a part of the land. Negotiations were concluded with the CMDA for the sale of 63 acres at about rupees 1 lakh per acre, and a further 1 acre was given free for extinguishing the two rights of way which had existed in the property from inception. While the full area was handed over in 1972, it took over 30 years more for the passages, the rights of way, to be extinguished. This slide here shows the full area of 208 acres and the two courses that existed at that time. After the sale of the land, part of the land of the new course, the course was redesigned by the legendary Peter Thompson of Australia. And this map shows the course as it existed in 1978, which I believe is more or less as it stands now. The old course was considered to be as good as any championship course in the world, and the standard of the leading players was very high. An ex-captain has recorded that when he came out to Calcutta in the early 1930s, he lived in a chummery with three others, and the combined handicap of the four of them was 2.
Wow.
Not only were the players very accomplished, they also enjoyed life to the hilt. And there's a story of a club team traveling to Rangoon for an inter-club match by steamer, a journey that took about 2 days. The steamer's large gin stocks, however, ran out even before it passed Sandheads. The Royal have some very well-known visiting golfers, including the great Walter Hagen, winner of several major championships before the Second War, and Diaries, Harry Wheatman, and Ken Bousfield after the war to play exhibition matches. During Walter Hagen's visit, we are told he stepped onto the first tee on the morning of the match with his dinner jacket still on, not having slept a wink.
Oh, that's wonderful.
Well, apparently, this did not affect the quality of his golf, and he still played superbly. Diaries was the captain of the British Ryder Cup team, and a picture of Diaries on the first tee in an exhibition match is shown here, which also shows I.S. Malik in white, and behind him, George Willard, the club professional who were part of that exhibition match. One of the club's most treasured possessions is the watercolor of three of the greatest golfers in the history of the game, James Braid, Harry Warden, and J.H. Taylor. The portrait bears the signatures of all three and was presented by Mr. R. Duncan, the captain of the club, in March 1915. This used to be displayed in the bar, and I hope it is still there.
I would probably ask Dr. Singh, is it still there at the club?
I remember seeing it, but it's not there at this time. I think because of a lot of work being done earlier, also it has been put in safe custody.
Well, it is actually a historic relic work keep.
It is,
yeah. Wow. So that's such an interesting concept, sir. But would you like to tell us that when did Indians first get integrated into this absolutely British establishment? And was it difficult for Indians to get integrated, you know, with the Britishers?
Well, I'll answer the second part first. Indians had, once they were taken in, they had no difficulty in integrating with the rest of the membership. But all new members at that time, including the Britishers, were admitted as B members and had to do a 2-year apprenticeship before they were promoted to A membership. During this period, they could not play on the old course over the weekend. This rule also applied to me when I joined the club in 1959, although I was then the reigning national champion.
You were the national champion. And you had to play the B course. You were not allowed to play the old course. Is that right?
Well, the club, I think quite rightly, very particular about the rules and traditions, and they made no exceptions in these rules.
Wow.
Coming to the Indian membership, as was the practice in almost all clubs in the major cities, Indians were not allowed as members, and in some cases this continued well after independence. However, they were allowed to play in the national championship, the All India, from about 1930 onwards. My uncle and father had both won the Northern India Championship in Gulmarg in Kashmir, and they started playing in the All India in the early 1930s. My father referred to this as his annual pilgrimage to Mecca. He got into the semi-final in 1932 and the finals in 1934 and 1945. I think this largely prompted the committee to invite him to become a member in 1946. Incidentally, there was no championship during the period 1939 to 1944 during the Second World War. The balloting for membership in those days was by the full membership of the club, and it became apparent to the committee that they would not get the required yes votes. So they put in extra black balls when the meeting took place to make the ballot invalid. The rules of the club were then changed to enable the committee to decide on new entrants for membership. And my father, I.S. Malik, and a senior executive from Tata's, Manik Pawala, became the first Indian members towards the end of 1946. An interesting sequel to the election of and the welcome to Indian members was in 1948 when Lord Mountbatten was the first Governor General of Independent India and visited Calcutta. He accepted an invitation from the UK community for dinner on the condition that it be held at the Royal, as apart from the Calcutta Club, the Royal was the only club regularly used by Europeans which had full Indian membership.
So for, do we have a record of this event? Do we have a photograph or a...
We don't have a record of the dinner, but there is a photograph of Lord Mountbatten, I think autographed by him, which used to be placed just outside the Mountbatten dining room. After the Second War, Japanese were not taken in as members until 1964. It took some time to forget the horrors of the war.
So what were the notable club traditions of the past?
Well, one of them, I think in keeping with the most golf clubs all over the world, not just in India, but all over the world, was that ladies were not admitted as members.
Yes, so actually my question was that, were that when did the club open its door to lady members?
Okay, I anticipated that and I started off on that. They were not permitted to sit in the shamiana, which was shown earlier, and had to change and then sit in the main clubhouse. Which the main clubhouse actually was not a bad place to sit in. It had very large, imposing boards which showed the winners of the various competitions. A second shamiana was built sometime in the 1960s or early 1970, which was a mixed shamiana where they could sit. And this picture over here, that's right, that's the mixed shamiana which came up. Much later, they were grudgingly allowed to sit in the main shamiana. However, before that became official, one evening I noticed to my horror, my wife sitting there. She had apparently been invited by the captain. I was then much younger and more foolish and picked up the chair with my wife sitting on it and gently deposited it outside the holy precincts of the shamiana. I will add that we're still happily married.
You're a lucky man, sir.
Ladies were given full membership only in the mid-1980s when Miss Basant Singh became a full member. However, I would like to add that this was several years before the leading clubs of the world like the Royal and Ancient and the Augusta National, home of the great Masters Tournament in the US, took in lady members.
I remember Mrs. Basant Singh used to attend every annual general meeting of the club.
That's amazing. So will you tell us something about the tournaments or championships which the club has organized over the years?
Yeah, well, I think I'll start with the club tournaments, and like most golf clubs, the Royal had many tournaments for trophies that are represented by clubs not only in India but also from abroad, apart from their own trophies. The Royal and Ancient Golf Club also presented a trophy to the RCGC. The most important of the club championships was a trophy instituted in 1929, the centenary year of the club. And this became the club championship. It is called the Centenary Cup. It's pictured over here.
Sir, I believe you have an exact replica of this cup with you.
Yeah, it is in fact behind me on this side.
Right.
And I had this made before I left Calcutta.
Wow.
The RCGC was unofficially recognized way back in the 1890s as the governing body of golf in India and was responsible for starting the All India in 1892. This, incidentally, is the second oldest national amateur championship in the world after the British amateur. It is 3 years older than the US amateur. For the first 4 years, it was played over the Dum Dum course and the two courses on the Maidan. And then when the Dum Dum course closed, it was shared between Tolly and the Maidan for some years. And from 1899 onwards, it was played exclusively on the course of the Tolly Ganj Club, which initially was 9 holes extended to 14 and then the final 18 holes, I think, in 1906. From 1916 to 1929, it was played alternately at the Tolly and at the Royal, as the Royal's old course by then had fully matured. From 1930 till 1957, it was played exclusively on the old course of the Royal. As I said, the RCGC was the governing body of golf in India and very magnanimously decided to start the Indian Golf Union and hand over the role of managing golf in India to the IGU, which came into being towards the end of 1956. Once that happened, the IGU started rotating tournaments between the different venues in the country. At this stage, I would like to bring in a personal note. My father, I.S. Malik, played in the All India. And this is a picture of him playing and receiving the trophy from Dr. Karchew in 1950, who was then the governor of West Bengal. My father played in the Royal about approximately 25 times. And during that period, he got into the finals a total of 9 times and won 3 of those. I think it speaks for itself.
Absolutely, sir.
Would you like to switch over to the...
Yeah, so the next... we also have actually, you know, a rather surprise for you. We have a picture of a young Mr. Ashok Malik with us. So here he is.
That's almost a century ago.
Thank you so much, Mr. Malik, for such a fascinating insight into the history and development of the RCGC.
Not at all.
Really fascinating. Thank you very much. I now turn my attention to Dr. Singh. Dr. Singh, as we are a heritage and conservation body, we would be very interested to learn from you about the architecture and style of the building.
Thank you, Gaurav. The iconic clubhouse that you see on your screen was started in 1913. As the minutes of committee meeting of June 1913 show, the contract was awarded to McIntosh Byrne and Company for a sum of ₹86,000 only.
I'm amazed, sir, to you know that you all still are preserving these records.
We have all the records from 1895 onwards, you know.
Wow, that's truly remarkable.
As the next slide shows, even small details like design of brackets, etc., were meticulously checked and approved by the committee. Next photograph shows, this was taken in 1913, towards the end of 1913, and it shows that the work progressed at a fast pace and building outline was ready even before the end of the year. You can see the chimneys protruding on top.
Amazing.
Now the design of the clubhouse was inspired by Tudor-style structure with a sense of British colonial architecture. It has steeply sloping pitched roof with patterned tiles, windows with columns and keystones, decorative fireplace with chimneys, cornices, brackets, all adding to the grandeur of this heritage structure. All these...
Yeah, if I may add, I think this would be probably the only Tudor style building existing in Calcutta.
Yes.
Okay.
The building is load-bearing structure with thick brick walls. The beams and columns that you see were made of steel and clad with Surki mortar. Lime Surki mortar was also used for plastering and for creating other decorative works like moldings, beadings, etc. There was liberal use of wood in making windows, shutters, doors, and stairs.
And I would presume that the wood being used would be all Burma teak?
Say it again, Gaurav, it was not clear. I couldn't hear you.
I'm saying I would presume that the wood being used would be all Burma teak.
The wood was all Burma teak, right.
Okay.
That time, the wood was so cheap, nobody ever thought of any other wood. Okay. But
Can you tell us something about the original layout of the clubhouse? Is that available with you?
Unfortunately.
So, you know, and also the additions and modifications that has happened to the original structure over the last couple of decades.
Okay, unfortunately, we don't have the original layout plan available. The current floor plan, can we have it on screen, the current floor plan?
Yeah.
Yeah, it shows the original M-shaped symmetrical plan along with additions made over the years. Initially, it was an open floor plan with only enclosed area being the men's changing room in the northwest corner and a small bar in the southern part of the building. The area in front of men's changing room was partitioned. This was partitioned with movable wood partition and was only for use by men. Eventually, another separate informal men's bar was added to the informal, this men's only area. Rest of the area was open veranda and it was open to be used by families. Anybody could use that area except for the area in front of men's changing room. The ground floor changing room had an internal staircase to the first floor changing room. No, it was, if you see the toilet block now, just below the, yeah, these were the staircases here.
Okay.
The ground floor changing room had an internal staircase to the first floor changing room. This was used mostly by the seniors. Since it had a number of planters chairs to rest and sleep on.
So have you slept on any of those planters chairs, sir?
They were quite spacious. You could lie down totally with your back leaning. I mean, back would look like a pillow, you know.
Right. So and I would also ask Mr. Malik that
even in our time, we have seen this in the change room. And
Mr. Malik, sir, have you also used the planter chairs?
No, when I joined the club, I was a chokra, so I wasn't allowed to go upstairs to the upstairs area.
On the first floor, on the southeast corner, there was secretary's residence. Southeast, yeah, that area, there was secretary's residence, and it was used till about 5 years ago. Now it's being used as temporary office.
So, what have been the additions and modifications after that, sir?
There have been some alterations and additions over the years to meet the needs and demands of the time. A wing was added on the south side to meet the requirement of kitchen, pantry, store, and generator room. There have been alterations in the open veranda over the years. Walls were added to create formal dining room, AC lounge. In AC lounge, you can see the original pillar type of structure
Right.
and the cornices and decorations, you know. These were all restored.
So even the ceiling is original in this part of
Ceiling is
the.
original also. The roof was again restored to the original way. False ceilings was removed.
Right.
AC bar, billiards and snooker room. These were the additions in the main building. Later on, the first floor changing room was converted to a party room with open terrace and a conference room. In the early 90s, a new building was added to the west side of original heritage structure to accommodate a new open shamiana, pro shop, and a modern gym. Care was taken to match the original heritage building, and the backside of this shamiana, you can see, pro shop occupies the backside. Here, in the second picture, you come to the front side, that will. And this
Right.
is the modern gym, which was.
So this gym is on the top of the new Shamiana.
It is in the first floor of New Shamiana.
So also we understand that the club has been carrying out extensive renovations to the clubhouse, and we would like to understand from you the various challenges and problems which you may have encountered in the process of restoration and maintenance of a heritage structure. Could you please tell us more about it?
Yes, yeah. See, RCGC clubhouse has been regularly maintained and upgraded by successive committees over the past 100 years, unlike many other buildings in Kolkata. Still, we face many challenges. Water leakage and seepage is one major concern. Over the years, multiple layers of screed concrete and tar felting was added onto the open terrace to address this issue. However, this added to the weight and caused cracks to appear. Water seepage through these cracks resulted in corrosion of reinforced structure. You can see the work being done, testing being done to check the level of corrosion. Other challenges, gutter pipes, gutters, pipes, sewerage lines are very old and require replacement and repair. Same with electrical lines and plumbing. The parapet, the cornices, moldings, all due to years have lost their original shape and they all require attention. The club has done extensive testing to determine the condition of the building. Mr. Kalyan Chakravarti, the KMC's conservation architect, helped us with this.
So, sir, what are the issues which you need to address now?
Gaurav, if we see the next slide,
Right.
we have mentioned that these are the work needs to be done, like repairing of pitched roof, you know, damaged parts of the framework. A pitched roof will be restored and replaced with replicas. Damaged plaster, which you saw in previous slides, and brickwork. Damaged plasters will be removed and replastering done with a mix of cement, lime, and sand composite to the original thickness. Damaged bricks will be carefully removed. Repointing of the brick joints will be done with lime, surki, and ajwain molasses, which are eco-friendly and antifungal. Electrical lines will be reorganized to return the building to original aesthetics. Old lights are being replaced with LED to conserve power and make the building green. Wooden items like staircases, windows, and shutters will be repaired and repolished with traditional wood polish and lacquer finish. With large amount of woodwork in the club, it's imperative that extensive termite treatment is done.
That's quite a task, sir.
So
could you also please share the focus which will be required for conservation in the years to come?
Well, it's there on the next slide. It is very important that we follow the regular regime of inspection and maintenance to enhance the life and to keep the building in pristine condition. A small effort will go a long way in preserving our heritage. We suggest periodic inspection and checkup by the conservation architect, regular termite treatment, regular checkup of open terraces and overhead reservoirs to ensure no water accumulates there, regular weeding of unwanted plants on the structure, avoid patchwork repair, and if necessary, to use the latest scientific and conservation tools to do the same. And finally, a proper coat of breathable paint on the exterior every 5 years or so. Before I end, I would like to emphasize that heritage structures can also be very functional. Here at RCGC Club, as you have seen in previous slides, every inch of the area is fully and properly utilized. Thank you.
That was truly fascinating. In fact, you know, the amount of effort which is being done to preserve a heritage structure, I'm sure, you know, the structure will continue to survive for maybe another 100, 200 years.
We would like it to survive forever.
Yes, absolutely. And thank you for such an informative discussion. You know, our collective is a group of passionate people, you know, interested in restoration and preservation of old heritage structures. And I'm sure they have all learned a lot from your presentation. So I would, you know, trying to bring this conversation to a close, I would now like to go back to both of you, to Mr. Malik and to Dr. Singh, and to also now share with us some of the happier and fun moments you all have spent at the club. What memories do you have, sir?
Well, there are many fond memories and many stories. I think it would take too long to recount them. But I'd just conclude my part of the session by recounting a couple of anecdotes. On one occasion, after a particularly late and wet Saturday evening in the Shamiana, the Darwan awakened the secretary at about 3 a.m. to tell him that a member was asleep in his car. Secretary got dressed, went and knocked on the window of the car. The member immediately jumped to attention and said, "Don't bother me, can't you see I'm driving?"
That's a golf lover.
Finally, on a Saturday afternoon, and Saturdays seemed to be particularly wet, a well-known four ball walked off the 18th green, feeling very tired. The group was known to consume more than its allotted ration of chota pegs, but for some reason decided to order tea. their usual bearer, known by the wonderful name of Dopey, came over to the table to take their order. One of them said, "Char cha." Dopey could not believe what he had heard, and remembering past experience, figured out that the crazy sahibs must mean char char, and bought them 16 chota pegs. The Royal is now approaching its 200th anniversary. Long may the chota pegs flow.
Yes, truly. Dr. Singh, you were telling us also of a funny incident that day.
Yes, I heard that. Alan MacDonald, the captain in 69-70, was invariably the last man to leave the bar on party nights. He was under the impression that distilleries were invented for him only. He was a brilliant speaker, and at the AGM, he finishes his captain's speech and then said, "Gentlemen, I would like to propose a toast tonight that I think has never been done before. I raise my glass to my wife and my driver, who serve, who sit and wait."
That truly speaks of golf windows, sir.
Anyway, yes.
Indeed. Thank you, Mr. Malik, and thank you, Dr. Singh. This entire interaction has been so fascinating for all our viewers, and we can't thank you enough.
Not at all.
Thank you. Thank you, Gaurav. It has been a learning experience for us also.
And at this stage, actually, I'm opening the floor to the both of you to answer the many questions we have received on FB Live and also through WhatsApp. In the amount of time remaining, we may probably just have time for two or three questions. The first question is from a Mr. Bill Shepherd for Mr. Malik. Sir, do you remember playing with Peter Osterhaus?
Peter Osterhaus actually came out, I think, as part of the Eisenhower Cup team, the British Eisenhower Cup team, on their way to Australia. This must have been about 1968. I don't know whether I actually played with him, but the British team had a few rounds of golf at the Royal before going on to Australia.
Okay. He is, in fact, probably mentioned on the chat that he has fond memories of RCGC growing up in Calcutta, and his father, William James Shepherd, worked for Avery Scales and was a life member at RCGC. He still has his membership card. And I think Mr. Iyengar was the club captain then, if he remembers correctly.
Well, that must be correct. I'm not quite sure which year Mr. Iyengar was the captain.
Okay. We have a second question from Rupande Shah, and this is for Dr. Singh. Dr. Singh, you mentioned that the extension was made to the structure to house the gym and pro shop. What were the type of materials used, and how different were they from the original materials used to build the clubhouse?
Gaurav, I wouldn't be very sure about it. When this shamiana was made, mostly contemporary material was used, along with traditional material like surki, etc., for plastering. I won't be able to say very much on it. I don't know much.
Okay. So we have the last question here. And this is from Rajiv Soni. This is to Mr. Malik. Sir, do you recall if the Maidan Pavilion was built on wheels?
Well, it's, I think all pavilions, when they were sanctioned originally, and perhaps the practice still continues, were required to be on wheels. And I think the reason was, initially at least, for security purposes. The idea was to get clear sight from Fort William. And this would have been before all the big buildings in Chowringhee came up. So if there was any hostile action, the view from the fort was not to be blocked. So these pavilions were, in fact, movable and could be moved out of the line of sight.
Okay.
I may add, Gaurav, that Calcutta Ladies Golf Club Pavilion is still on wheels.
Okay. Sir, there's one more last question, and this is again to Dr. Singh. Does the club have initiatives to promote the sport and make it accessible to the youth? For example, you know, there could be children whose parents are not members of the club. So can they come and use the club facilities?
Yes, what we have is we have a training program, and people can come and take lessons, but no, it's not possible for everybody to come in there. Otherwise, we won't have time to play golf there, you know.
Right.
Yes, we look at the talented people. We have programs tied up with schools where we try to teach the children, and who are promising are given junior memberships.
Thank you, sir.
Now, I'd just like to add over here that during the year that I was the IGU president, it must have been about 1989-90, we in fact had a scheme when we went to the various schools and looked for good sportsmen and invited them to come and practice and limited amount to play. And Rahil Ganji, who went on to become a very successful professional, was the product of this particular initiative at that time.
That's incredible, sir. So this brings us to a close of the third episode in our series, Clubs in Spades, brought to you by the Calcutta Heritage Collective. On behalf of the collective, I would like to thank both of our esteemed speakers for their valuable time and effort in helping us create this episode. We are living in challenging times, as you know, and despite constraints of not physically meeting each other, your wholehearted participation has helped us make this event so enjoyable. I have personally learned a lot and enjoyed myself immensely in learning so much about the RCGC. Thank you so much.
It's been a pleasure.
Thank you.
I also take this opportunity on behalf of Calcutta Heritage Collective to thank the RCGC captain, Mr. Ashish Doshi, who very enthusiastically took up our idea and helped us immensely at every stage. And I now would also like to thank the entire team of Calcutta Heritage Collective, without whose contributions of time and coordination this would have not been possible. And a special thanks to my friend Nikita, who has literally handheld me to put together the entire episode. I also thank our members and viewers for their valuable time. We would also request our viewers to tune in for our forthcoming episodes in this series, Clubs in Spades. The details will be circulated in due course. A very good evening to all of you. Thank you.